Hey now, Rodney R. Dixon here, and I'm sure if you're a do-it-yourself computer builder like I am, you've probably run into this problem before. Power up my computer, the fans spin up, the optical drives and the hard drive spin up, but yet there's no image on the screen, no video output, and no post-beep error message codes. Nothing. Pressing the reset button simply recycles the spinning up of the hard drives and optical drives. Yet, still no beep error messages, no image on screen, nothing. Pressing the power button on the chassis, nothing. Pressing it again, nothing. What you have to do in order to shut off the machine is hold the power chassis button until it powers down. So what do we do? Well, first of all, it helps to know what we're looking for. And what we're looking for is not necessarily what we see, but what we hear. We're looking for post-beep error message codes, which we're not getting. What do they mean, and what are we listening for? Essentially, on an Award modular BIOS, the beep codes are one beep when displaying logo means there's no error during post. Long beeps in an endless loop means there's no system RAM installed or detected. One long beep followed by three short beeps means the video card is not found or the video card's memory is bad. And high frequency beeps when the system is working means the CPU is overheating and the system's running at a lower frequency. So, with that having been said, what can we do to remedy the problem? Sadly, in most cases, I'd say easily over 50% of cases, when this happens, your motherboard is good for garbage. Essentially, what's happening is the CMOS, the memory that governs and stores what all the components of the computer are, how they are interconnected to the motherboard, and how they are managed and work together, becomes confused, and there's no way to remedy the situation. So, but it... Suffice to say, it doesn't hurt to at least try to remedy the situation before basically deciding that your motherboard's bad and good for the garbage. So how are we going to do this? The first thing we're going to do is we're going to try to clear the CMOS memory. So whenever working in the computer, it's very important that you cut power to the power supply before you work in here. You wouldn't want to get a nasty shock. So what you can do is you could have your power supply cable feed hooked up to a power bar where you have an on-off switch and you could cut the power that way. Or if you don't have that method, and since I'm on a camera right now, I'll do it the good old-fashioned way, which is I'm going to pull out the power feed. I've disconnected my power feed. I'm now going to press the power chassis button on the computer, and this is just to discharge any remaining power that's circulating through the system. Once that's done, I am going to alternatively tap with my fingers on the power supply to discharge any static electricity that could be stored in my body that could negatively affect and possibly damage computer components. If you have one of those anti-static bracelets, it would help to wear that. Once that's done, what we're going to do is we're going to remove the CMOS battery. In order to do this, I recommend you use a flathead screwdriver. You locate the CMOS battery. In my case, it's right here. There you go, that round button cell battery. And what we're going to do is you'll see that it has its socket, its holster in plastic, and a metal clasp that holds it in place. What we're going to do is we're going to take the tip of the flathead screwdriver, we're going to wedge it between the button cell battery and that metal clasp, and we're going to try to wedge it out. If it doesn't come out easily, what you could do is you could hold the clasp to the side and then try to dig it out with a fingernail. There you go, as so. Essentially, the connector at the bottom, the electrical connector, works as a spring as well. So when the metal clasp is removed from the top of it, it will pop out a bit, allowing you to get in under there and pop it out with your finger. Or, of course, you could use another screwdriver. So once this is removed, putting that aside, what it also helps to do is very close to the button cell battery, the CMOS battery socket, is a reset jumper, which resets the CMOS, essentially dumps all the CMOS settings that are stored in memory and allows you to start anew. Now here's the thing, if you don't know where your CMOS jumper is, in my case on this computer it's right next to the button cell battery socket, it's possible it's elsewhere on the motherboard. If you don't know where yours is, of course consult your user's manual. Now for those who don't know, it should also be noted that what I'm doing right now isn't deleting settings from my hard drive, it isn't deleting anything I've saved on my computer, aside from the CMOS settings. And what the CMOS settings are, just to recap and to ensure, to put people at ease, is, once again, it's the settings that the motherboard stores of the components that are connected and how they interoperate within the motherboard. These are not the same as drivers that are on your operating system. Everything on your operating system, whether it be Windows or other, I assume it's Windows, on your hard drive is not affected by anything we're doing. It's just the initial settings. You know, when you power up your computer and you see that very simple, very almost basic, you know, black and white screen, and it's that, so. Okay, so once that's done, the button cell is removed. Ideally, you're supposed to wait between 5 and 30 minutes. For the sake of this video, I will not wait that long, but suffice to say, I know that isn't my problem here in my case. Your case can obviously be different. So what you do, once you remove that button cell battery, is you're going to locate your CMOS jumper, and it has two settings. It has, generally it's three pins, covers the first two, the jumper cap, or it covers the second two. When it covers, from its resting place, when it's moved to cover the second two pins, what it's doing is it is dumping all of the CMOS memory and allowing you to start anew, start from scratch for the CMOS. So I'm going to do that right now. Remove the CMOS jumper. If you can't get it, it helps to have one of these little jumper removing hooks. But if you don't have that, you could also use a pin. If you, of course, don't have the nails to do it, or tweezers. Or what I used to use is mechanical lead pencils. They often have a small lead, a small tube that's metal. That also works well too. So I've removed my jumper cap from the 1-2 position. I'm now going to put it on the 3-4 position, the 2-3 position, excuse me. There we go, covering those two pins number 2 and 3. Going to wait around 5 seconds. Once again, you could wait around 5 minutes to ensure that everything's done, dumped. For the sake of this video, I won't wait that long. And what I just did is, now that I waited my, you know, theoretical 5 minutes, my 5 minutes in reality time, but on video, 30 seconds, I placed it back on the resting position, the 1-2 pins, and let's see if that solves my issue. Take my power feed. Plug it into my power supply and power up. Listening for those post-beep error messages. Still nothing, as I knew. Okay, so now that that's done, I'm going to power down the system as usual by holding that power chassis button. I'm going to remove the power feed. I'm going to press the power chassis button again to get rid of any possible stored energy. Alternatively, tap my power supply, and there we go. It starts again. Now what this is similarly to what I did with the CMOS battery, although I won't replace the CMOS battery for now, the button cell battery. You're only going to replace the button cell battery once you've gone through your entire diagnosis and you've either found the problem or discovered that your motherboard is useless and good for garbage. Since the CMOS battery saves the CMOS configuration in the CMOS, that isn't my goal, that isn't what I want to do. So once again, only if your problem is solved do you replace the CMOS battery. Okay, so we've discovered that it is not the information stored in CMOS from the past, so it must be a conflict currently. Now, like I said prior, it is possible that the conflict in the CMOS and how your motherboard governs these components is essentially at this point eternal. You cannot solve it. There's no way to get around it, and your motherboard's good for garbage. This is the case in, I'd say, like I said, over 50% of the time. And this has existed, or has become quite common ever since the Pentium 3 generation of computer going up. So, what we're going to do is, one by one, we're going to remove a component, power up, and see if we get those post-beep error codes. If we do, we've discovered that that component is the problem. So, once again, alternatively tap power supply. Now, ideally, I would want to start with RAM, but the way many computers are configured is that the RAM modules are inaccessible until components are removed, such in this case, my video card, which blocks access to the RAM module. So I'm going to start with the video card. I've already taken out the retention screw. I've already removed the components connected to the video card in the back, very important. Once that's done, I have an additional power feed to my video card, going to disconnect that. There is a retention bracket at the bottom of modern video cards, right next to the socket, that clips over the hook in the connector. So make sure that is out. And now gently, I'm going to grab with fingers, one finger outside the retention bracket and one finger on the edge, and I'm going to gently rock back and forth until it has disconnected from its socket. There we go. It's now disconnected from its socket. I'm now going to remove the video card. The way you would do this is it is okay to grab part of the printed circuit board. Just make sure you're not grabbing anything with either a chip or a capacitor or transistor, a connector, anything of that nature. Wouldn't want to cause damage. There we go, my video card's removed. I can put this in an anti-static bag for the meantime, or I could simply put it on a metal surface. Ensure that there's nothing protruding from your metal surface that could possibly damage the printed circuit board. There we go. Once again, gonna static discharge. Gonna plug in my power feed. And let's see if this solved the problem. No post-beep error codes, still nothing. Alright then. Gonna hold the power button, power down. Same steps, remove power supply. Power supply cable feed, I should have been more clear, sorry. You're not removing the power supply. Okay. Press the power chassis button, discharge at power. Okay, now onto the RAM modules. Technically, you can remove one RAM module at a time, or if you want to be quick about it, you could remove all three, and then work your way back one at a time. Same concept, release the retention brackets on each side, grasp the RAM modules, and gently rock while pulling up from back to forth until they disconnect from their sockets. There we go. Here are my RAM modules. Same concept, can put them on a metal surface. Ensure that there's no protruding parts of the chassis that can do damage to them. Gonna connect my power supply feed. And gonna power up. Well, what do you know? There's the beeps. Now that's one long beep on an endless loop. What that means is that there is no system RAM installed. So, essentially, we've diagnosed our problem as far as this machine goes. Of course, your machine will probably be different. Gonna hold the power chassis button till it powers down. Gonna disconnect the power supply feed. Going to press once again the power chassis button to discharge any remaining power. Alternatively tap, discharge the electricity on my hands if there are any, and there we go. From here on in, I no longer have to remove components because I've diagnosed my problem. Now my problem has to do with the way RAM is managed on this machine, on this particular motherboard. Essentially what I'm going to do from this point on is I'm going to try different configurations. I'm going to try one module, power up, see if I get my post-beep message. If I do, good. Going to power down, going to try two RAM modules, power up, see if I get my post-beep messages. If I do, good. Power down, put in three, see if that's what causes the problem. Also going to try to change the order of RAM socket that they fall into, see if that solves the problem. If I cannot find the combination of these three RAM modules, even in different orders, that function, then what I'll have to do is maybe settle for two RAM modules, maybe replace one of the RAM modules if I have extras, etc., etc. That's how I'm going to find the combination that works for me. If in your case, after removing the RAM, you still don't get post-beep error codes, what you're going to do is you're going to continually, one at a time, removing components, powering up, no post-beep error code, cut power, discharge power, remove another component, connect power, power up, and continue and continue and continue until you find your problem. Like I said, in over 50% of cases, you will not find a problem and your motherboard is good for garbage. But doesn't hurt to try, it just takes time. So essentially what you're going to do is one at a time, like I said, you're going to remove every component, including connected ports such as USB, FireWire, Thunderbolt, whatever you have. Connected components to the back, including, once again, FireWire, USB, Thunderbolt, things of that nature. Storage mediums, whether it be SATA or PATA, essentially your good old IDE, floppy drive connectors, if anybody still uses those. You know, you're going to remove every single component one at a time until you find the source of your problem. Hopefully, you do. Until you're down to your motherboard with your processor and fan and power supply. If at that point you still don't find the source of your problem, well, at that point, it's safe to say that your motherboard has done its time. It's good for garbage. Of course, your processor could still be good, as well as, of course, your processor fan. And all the components you've disconnected can still be good. Maybe you could try to sell them on sites like Craigslist or Kijiji. You know, hope for the best. Important to note, before I let you go, that there is also the possibility that the problem lies in something that I neglected to mention, the power supply. Essentially, what happens with power supplies is, over time, their output, their power output diminishes, similar to a battery. The more you use a battery, the weaker it gets, and sooner or later it can no longer put out the power needed to run your devices. Same thing happens with power supplies. They get weaker and weaker as months and years go by. It also helps towards, you know, after you've done this whole diagnosis, if you still can't find a problem, it could be your power supply that it's done its time. It is possible, I'm sure you've deduced, that a power supply can still power up a system so that fan spin, the optical and hard drive spin up, but doesn't allow you to access post and access your BIOS and what have you. If that's the case, you could obviously try a different power supply and hope that helps. Once again, in over 50% of cases, I have to repeat this, your motherboard has done its time and you simply can't repair the issue. But you never know. If you have the means to, you know, you have another power supply lying around or you could borrow somebody's, it doesn't hurt to try. And there you go. If you do manage to find the source of your problem, you reassemble your computer in a working state, and of course you want to remember to replace that CMOS battery, the button cell battery, at the end to ensure that you could then save the settings of your configuration. If you don't, well, like I said, I recommend you, you could always sell the components. You just have to remember that the motherboard's defective. And, yeah, you could sell all the components and hope for the best. Or you could just, you know, recycle your machine where recycling facilities exist for electronics. Or, you know, like I said, good for garbage, but ideally you would want to recycle it to protect the environment. So there you go. I'm going to leave you with that. I hope this information helps you. Once again, last time I'm going to say it, because I've said it many times, in over 50% of cases, all this process still won't solve your problem. Your problem is irrecoverable, and your system is good for garbage. Well, excuse me, your motherboard is good for garbage. Your other components are fine. But, hey, listen, you have under a 50% chance, but if you go through this process and you get your post-beep error message codes, then you're in the green. You can work your way up from there and recover your machine. Although, very possibly with different components or less components than you had prior. So there you go. I'll leave you with that. And as usual, all the best.